Alright, so let me go through a short review, as usually I do a review. So we talked about general remarks. We spent a lot of time on various things that one can do. We discussed simpler model problems, which are of a geometric type, like wave maps and needles. We discussed the symmetry reductions, the most interesting one being when you have just one vector field, which is one repeating vector field, and then we saw that we get a sort of a wave map type system coupled with a 2 plus 1 curvature. Then, of course, there is also the spatial symmetry reduction, which is, you can go a lot more, but it simplifies much further. And maybe we should have some lectures in the seminar. Maybe we'll have some lectures on, they will ask us to run deeper talk on spatial symmetric solutions. And then close to special solutions, that means like stability of Minkowski space, stability of black holes, the Kerr solution, and of course the Schwarzschild solution. Then conditional assumptions, so this is something that I didn't talk last time, so maybe I'll say a few words about it now. Then something which I didn't have before, but there are some other things that one can do, which do not follow into the first four categories. And then call others. Of course, there is a, it means you are not close now to anything. You are not, obviously, you're not close to a special solution. Plano singularity theorem is such a thing. It's a result where you are not close to anything. In fact, you have a trap surface, which is very far from anything that anything that will happen, for example, in Minkowski space. And there is another, so, but this is a very simple result, as we saw, it's an almost immediate application of the Einstein equations, using very little part of the Einstein equations. This is a much deeper result, where you want to start out with initial data which are not round, so which look more like Minkowski data, reasonable data, and you want to impose conditions so that the trap surface will form in the future. So this is a very big result of Christodoulou, recent result of Christodoulou, and Rodniansky and myself have a different proof which simplifies a lot. And also, hopefully I'll be able to talk about some new results which go a lot further than the original result of Christodoulou. And of course, there is this other thing which I call rigidity results. So here, the conjecture, if you remember, was that the Kerr solution is unique in a family of stationary solutions. So if you have one time-like ineffective field, then you have some reasonable assumptions about the space-time, then you must be in Kerr. Okay, so this is a very deep rigidity result, which also I hope I have time to talk about. Okay, so let's go to conditional results. Okay, so here is a conditional result that I hope I'll be able to explain at least the main ideas at some point. So here is the situation. So imagine that you have an initial data set, sigma zero. And you try to describe the solution of the Einstein equation. So imagine that we have a space time. So I have a solution of the Einstein equations, which is globally hyperbolic in the sense we have discussed. It's foliated by a time function, so there is a foliation equal constant. There is such a foliation. In fact, this condition is essentially equivalent to global hyperbolicity. So, I mean, if you have this, you have global hyperbolicity. This foliation. And the metric relative to this foliation is given upstairs, so it's minus n squared d squared plus gij dxi dj, where this is a Riemannian metric now on the least of the foliation, and n is a lapse, so n in a sense measures how the distance between these leaves of the foliation. Now, there are two cases which one can consider. One is the case when these are maximal. So if you remember, that means trace k has to be zero. So trace relative to the induced metric on sigma t has to be zero. And asymptotically flat here. So we are in the asymptotically flat regime. Or you can take sigma t compact, so you have contact. So this is cosmological, as I according to our terminology, this is a cosmological case. You have these sections are compact, they are multiplied by this one, and you take a constant mean curvature foliation. So it's not taking trace k equals zero, take trace k equals constant. Okay. So these are two things. Both of them are put essentially in the same way. So the theorem, which is due to Rodiansky and myself, and a student of mine has given a slightly better version, slightly stronger version, says that the space-time together with the foliation can be continued without any problems, in other words, there are no singularities, as long as the infinity norm of k, so the second fundamental form, and the derivative of this log n of the lapse are bounded in an infinity, and if, well, when you integrate in time, you should get something which is less than infinity, something which is not. Another way of stating the result is that if you take t to be uninormal to the foliation, so this is a time-like vector field, and you take the derivative of the space-time metric relative to t in an infinity and you integrate, then you should get something less than infinity. Okay.
So, t is the trace of k, and t is time also.
Yeah, so t is this is time function that I have here. So
the trace of k is exactly that function.
No, trace of k would be it can be normalized to be that function if I'm in CMC, right? But for example, I can take trace k with zero, right? In the maximum. In fact, I talk mainly about this because in principle I'm talking about the asymptotically flat, but the same thing holds also in the half like it. Right, so this is essentially equivalent to this one. But of course it tells you that somehow it gives you a measure of how far you are from the case where t is killing. If t is killing, of course, that is equal to zero. So if you are not too far away from the stationary case, it's roughly what this says. Actually, it's static because t is also hypersurface orthogonal. If you're not too far away from the static case, static regime, then the space time can be continued indefinitely. Okay. So, for a singularity to form, you have to have this quantity become infinite, which of course can happen. Okay. So, that's why I call this a conditional result. Okay, so the remarks is that this is a large data result. I make no assumptions about the smallness of initial data. And this is not too important at this point. This has any remarks. I'll discuss about it later. Okay, so just a few more remarks about such a result. It's related to other conditional results in nonlinear DTs. So for example, one result that I want to talk about, because it's a very good illustration of this conditional result, is a result of early and Markov here, which is a result for the Young-Mills equation. So the Young-Mills equation in R3 plus 1, right? So in four dimensions. This is actually a global existence result, unconditional. It turns out that it's an unconditional result, but somehow the philosophy behind the proof of this result is similar to the proof of our conditional result for general relativity. So that's why I want to mention it here. So this is a result that says that if you start up, you are in Minkowski space. I'm talking about the Minkowski space now. If you start up with initial data, which is reasonable, any reasonable initial data, that means data which behaves well at infinity and is sufficiently smooth, doesn't matter the assumption of the smooth initial smoothness, that's what takes infinity. The solution exists for all time, so Young-Mills doesn't blow up. And it turns out that the proof of this result, which goes back to the Eilenberg in 1982, is very relevant for the conditional result I mentioned earlier, which of course is much harder, but somehow some of the ideas are already disproved. Okay, so let me mention also there was a result, the previous result of Andersen in 2001, which required that the curvature, the Riemann curvature, be bound in that thing. So, of course, our result is much stronger, it's a one derivative less. Just a second. And it's of course a critical, our result is critical in the sense of scalings of the actual equations. While of course this one is not. Right? There is another famous result, this time in a totally different area of mathematics. It's the incompressive Euler equations. So it's a built out of Eilenberg result that tells you that the curl of the, if you control the curl of the velocity in an infinity, then nothing bad can happen. So even though it sounds it's similar, of course our result is much harder than this. But this is actually a relatively simple result, especially with the technology nowadays, it's almost a trivial result. Okay, but it's very interesting in that it gives you a hint of what can go wrong with solutions of the Euler equation. It tells you that you have to concentrate on the vorticity. The curl of the velocity is the vorticity. So only the vorticity can blow up. As long as you control the vorticity, nothing bad can happen. Alright, so let's see what I want to do now. So everything I've announced kind of an introduction. But I will give another introduction today on the wave equation. So wave propagation in Minkowski space, and then from here I'll branch out in this more complicated situations where the Minkowski metric is replaced by a Lorentz metric. But we should keep in mind certain goals. So maybe before going into this, I want to describe certain goals. First of all, one thing that I'd like to do is this certainly Mankiw. So I'd like to explain at least the proof of early Mankiw result for young means. So this was young means. In R1 plus 1. So this is this global regularity result that I mentioned earlier. It's, I think, extremely interesting. And nowadays, again, with what we know today, this is very easy to prove. And it gives you an illustration of ideas which can be used also in general. A second thing that I want to do is that I want to give you an idea of this global regularity result. But here I will not go into details at all. Maybe I'll just explain a few, some ideas. Global regularity result for wave maps. Wave maps in R1 plus 2. So these are these famous results which were proved recently by Stevens et al. And Terry Tau. Though Terry Tau's results are not quite complete, but in any case, he had many of them. He had many ideas for it. So this is for wave maps. A certain thing that I like to we have as a goal to explain, at least until the end of the semester, stability of Minkowski space, so global stability of Minkowski. Or formation of trap surfaces. Trap surfaces. So this is this result. So this is a long result of Christodoulou and myself. Formation of trap surfaces is a result of Christodoulou and more recently myself and Kolbianski. I like to explain the proof of this conditional result,
break down criteria for the Eilenberg equations. So this is a result of myself and Bonyansky, whose some contributions for one. And let's see, what else? Six, I'd like to mention, I'd like to talk a little bit also about rigidity results. So these are, again, rigidity of a Kerr solution among stationary solution. So this is sort of a very important aspect of general relativity, which has been settled in the analytic case, but not in the smooth case at all. So despite what physicists tell you, they will claim that this has been settled. It has not been settled. It has been settled only in the analytic case. And the analytic case is a cheat, as we'll see later. So the smooth rigidity in the smooth category, which is the true rigidity, is not yet known. But there are some results of your less true than myself, which I hope to talk about. And there are also some. So they are joint works with Jorge and myself, and also joint works with Jorge's group, myself, and Alex Sanders. All right, so this is basically the things that I want to keep in mind, and I make reference from time to time. But whenever I have some ideas which will come up in these discussions, I'll make references to these results. All right, so that's okay, so now I want to talk about wave propagation. So I want to give an idea, because many people here are not experts in wave equation. I want to give some ideas about what are the tools and what you can expect for solutions of the wave equation. So the plan is to talk about Minkowski space and its symmetries, fundamental solution of the wave equation in Minkowski space, what are the main properties of waves, and so on and so forth. You'll see it later on. Let's start. All right, so first of all, Minkowski space, of course, we already discussed. The only thing that I want to say here, in addition to what we have already discussed, which is the causal structure and the division between timeline and space-like and null vector field, I want to talk about the symmetries. Of course, this is a sort of very similar to the symmetries of Euclidean space, with some slight differences. So let's say what it is. So first of all, you can talk about isometries and conformal isometries. So I want to understand all the isometries and conformal isometries, but somehow, of course, to every one parameter group of isometry and one parameter group of conformal isometries, there is associated to them a Killing, respectively a conformal Killing vector field. And this is what I want to talk about, in fact, but I want to talk about the infinitesimal vector fields, Killing vector fields, which are denoted by T, L, S, and K. So let me write down what they are. Actually, you'll see it in a second. In fact, it's not here. There are, of course, the translations. The standard translations in Minkowski space, which correspond to the corresponding Killing vector fields, are the usual derivative with respect to coordinates T over T alpha, which are called D alpha. D alpha is a derivative, so this is a vector. They have Lorentz transformations. So these are isometries of Minkowski space, and the corresponding Killing vector fields are this is what they call L alpha beta, which is x alpha d beta minus x beta d alpha. So observe that I'm using the convention of lowering the indices. So normally coordinates should come up to upper indices. Lower indices means I'm using the metric to lower them. Okay, so these are the Lorentz Killing vector fields. Then there is scaling. So a scaling transformation, which just means you take a sub alpha into lambda x alpha, and the corresponding vector field is x alpha d alpha. Okay, so that's just that scaling. And finally, there are inversion. There is inversion and inverted translations. Right, so this is x alpha goes into x alpha divided by x mu x mu. Like this. Okay, so there's an inversion. And if you combine these translations, you get the so-called inverted translations. And the associated vector fields are conformal Killing vector fields. So these are now we are in R n plus 1 over 1 plus n. So Minkowski space, and of course, the basic operator is a wave operator, which is Minkowski then on eta v alpha eta or minus dt squared alpha plus. And we are interested in solving the equation that version of phi is equal to f. Okay, so obviously there are elementary things that you find it in all sorts of elementary books in partial differential equations. In particular, you can write down the fundamental solution. On the basis of homogeneity, it's obviously that you want to look at things like this, d squared minus x squared, and because of the dimension, you want to put minus and minus 1 over 2. This is sort of the analogous of what you do in the elliptic case if you want to find the Green function. Of course, this doesn't make any sense. Right? Doesn't make any sense, so you have to replace this with a distribution, and there is a family of distributions which is exactly beneath the homogeneity of this expression here. Okay? In the particular case when n is equal to 3, then actually the fundamental solution gets a nice expression, and then it's a delta function, so it's delta of t squared minus x squared. By the way, there should have been an ht here, which means heavy side. You are looking at the fundamental solution in the future direction, so you need to put a heavy side function. So obviously this is a fundamental solution which is supported in this light cone. It's supported everywhere here. If you are in dimension, in all dimensions, would be supported only on the light cone. So this is the difference between Huygens principle, strong Huygens principle, and just the Huygens principle. Right? In all dimensions, we have strong Huygens principle. So in this case, we have h plus t. This is a delta function, and you can rewrite this as. Delta of t minus absolute value of x divided by 1 over absolute value of x. So that, of course, there should be a constant. I obviously I'm not writing it. In all these cases, there should be a constant, you know, which you calculate in each particular situation. So this, once you have this, you immediately get the standard K4 formula, very useful. So the K4 formula tells you that phi, so if I look at this equation, phi is going to be, so phi at the point, DNS, it's going to be the integral over the light cone starting at the point x. And you go all the way to the initial data t equals 0. And here you have a 1 over the vertex, so the distance to the vertex, which I'm simply going to write it as 1 over absolute value of x. So this is just the distance to this vertex. And then you have f, yeah, and the sigma on the cone. So let's just write it like this. So you just simply integrate on the light cone, you integrate f with this wave. And so this is a solution of the initial value problem with zero data. So if you want to have also the data here, in other words, let's take phi is equal. I'm only going to write phi equals the simplest case, which is phi equals 0 dt phi is equal to f. This is a time t equals 0. So these are the initial data. I take special initial data. The general case is exactly the same, but just for simplicity, this will be here an integral over absolute value of x minus y is equal to t. And then you have f of y is sigma of y. And 1 over t, 4 pi t, I guess. This would be even the correct, I guess, 1 over 4 pi t. Though I'm not so sure about this constant. Okay, but something like this. Modulo constant, we have 1 over t, right? So, in other words, the solution at this point depends on the integral, so this is dx, depends on the integral of the initial data on this sphere. So this is just immediately, once you have the fundamental solution, you immediately get this one. Okay, now, So the next thing that I want to, so this is a typical formula in for n equal to 3. The energy method, we already discussed, maybe I'll mention a little bit more. Yeah. Just recall that. So we have energy method. So obviously, I can associate with the wave operator, I can associate this energy momentum tensor, about which we discussed earlier. Let me write the energy momentum tensor with Q because I'm more used to it. So the energy momentum tensor, so let's just look at this equation. The energy momentum tensor, so this is just a standard wave equation with zero data, with zero on the right hand side. Energy momentum tensor is dr power I, dv power I, minus a half. And then the metric, which in our case is a Minkowski metric, but I can, in general, it can be any Lorentz metric. And then we have m nu d nu of I d nu of I. This is just the Lagrangian of the wave equation. And recall that d beta q alpha beta is equal to 0. So this follows immediately from this equation. And q is symmetric, of course, and verifies a positive energy condition. So q of x, y is positive whenever x and y look like this. So this would be affected with x and y. Okay, so from this energy method, remember that we discussed it last time. If you look at q alpha beta and you multiply it by a vector field, so you take an arbitrary vector field x, and you differentiate the alpha of this. Well, you get, when this is 0, you get 0. Otherwise, you get q alpha beta, d alpha x beta, plus d beta x alpha. So 1 half here. And this is exactly the Lie derivative of x, Lie derivative of the metric with respect to x. So in particular, if x is skinning, you get an energy, you get an energy identity. You just integrate and you get an energy identity. So you get that. So let me write down the energy identity. So if you write E of I times t be 1 half e pi squared plus gradient of I squared. So this is a spatial gradient. So look at this expression, integrate it over sigma t, where sigma t is just a t equal constant on the surface in Minkowski space, then this is conserved, so E of, let me just write it like this, E of t is equal to E of 0. So this is a global conservation of energy, but of course you can do other things instead of integrating over, so you obtain this by just integrating it between, say, t equals 0, so you integrate over the whole entire region here, and you get the global energy is conserved. But you can also be smarter and integrate in regions like this, okay? In which case, you get that the flux of energy, but maybe I could do it a little bit. I take a truncated light form like this. So I have a region here, which is space-like. I have the boundary of the light form, which, and of course I have something at time t equals 0. So of course the energy here, in that case, will be plus the flux through this is equal to the energy here. Okay, so if you adopt this point of view, then you can immediately prove that you have uniqueness of solutions of the wave equation in this particular case. But you can also show that you have finite speed of propagation. So this gives you nearly finite speed of propagation uniqueness and many other things. And of course, this method is much more general. By the way, this is also the method which will give you regularity. So if you want to prove regularity of solutions, then obviously what you do is you look at the equation of the value of 0. You commute with derivatives, d alpha. right? So I can compute any types I please, and therefore I have also conservation of energy for as many derivatives as I want. Yes, only for a, meaning this is a product of derivatives of I. The time t is exactly the same as this time zero. So if you from this sort of things, you immediately get that the HS norm of the solution, so we get the HS norm of solutions, are preserved. In other words, if you start up with phi at time zero in HS, then the solution stays in HS at time t. Right? Okay, once you have this, you can also, if you have any sufficient regularity, in other words, if S is sufficiently large, you get by software inequality, you get estimates on the infinity norm. So this is, in fact, the only way which traditionally people were able to get the infinity norm from these energy estimates. And in fact, that's the way the solvent inequalities came into play at the very beginning, in the 1920s and 30s. That's exactly the reason why. It's exactly for understanding wave equations, understanding bounds for starting with energy. Okay, so that's sort of a very, very quick review. So let me now talk about the plane wave representations of solutions. Okay, so this is just the expression of the of solutions of the wave equation in Fourier space. Right, so start up again with dimension of phi equal to zero. And phi of zero with brackets means just the initial data. Okay? So the initial data is, of course, phi of zero and dt of phi of zero. And this time I'm going to take the first one to be f and the second one to be zero, because again, it's easier to write it this way. But as you can do the enthusiasm, do the general thing if you want, which is going to, these expressions are going to be more basic and so on. So phi of t of x by the inverse Fourier transform formula, you find immediately that it's e to the ix dot c cosine of t absolute value of c f half of psi. So f is a Fourier transform of the data. Right? Now, you see it's very useful to rewrite this as a plane wave representation of solutions of the wave equation in this way. I mean, I'm just going to introduce polar coordinates. So psi is lambda omega, where omega is on the units here. So I'm integrating now on the units here and from 0 to infinity. E to the I lambda x dot omega comes up from the cosine. If I express cosine in terms of e to the I t absolute value of psi plus e to the minus I t absolute value of psi. Okay. So I'm going to get two terms from cosine of that. This one is just cosine of t lambda here. Okay, so this is just cosine of t lambda. F hat of lambda omega lambda to z minus 1. And now I represent cosine of t lambda in terms of the sum of the exponentials. This gives me phi plus and phi minus. And they are just defined like this, where u plus omega is just this t, this one is t plus x dot omega. So you see it's a lambda plus t plus minus x dot omega. All right, so that's trivial. Now, however, I make an observation which is not so trivial. Let's start with this. First of all, let's observe that u plus minus verifies the equality. This is a triviality, right? In this case, it's just u plus x dot omega clearly verifies the equality. Of course, this is a null plane. U plus x dot omega equal constant is a null plane. So that's why this is a, it's called the plane representation of solutions of the wave equation. Okay, so now, redoing this, rewriting this here, so this is phi f, represented in that way. So phi f is just one of the phi plus phi minus, right? In fact, I took it to be exactly the plus part. The other one will be treated exactly the same. So the main calculation by which you verify that indeed phi f is a solution of the wave equation is this one. I take the version of phi f. the direction goes through the integrand. So I'm going to get the direction of this quantity, of the exponential. Right? So now, when you calculate the direction of this, you are going to get, first of all, you are going to get a derivative. The first time you differentiate, you get the d alpha of u. The second time I differentiate, I get the diversion coming out, which is coming in. And another term, which is the alpha beta d alpha of u d beta of u. But this is zero. Okay? So this term, by the end of my this term will be zero. So I'm just left to this. Now, in this particular case, when I'm in Minkowski space, and I have the explicit formula for u, so remember that u is imperfect to omega. So u is t plus minus x plus omega. Now it's trivial to check that the direction of u is zero. And that tells you that indeed you have a solution of the wave. Alright, now why is this important? Well, it's important because I can do the same thing even when the metric is not flat. So I can do the same thing in a non-Minkowskian metric. Okay? So in the non-Minkowskian metric, what do I need to do? Well, it's the same thing. I have a dimension of with respect to a metric G now of phi is equal to zero. Right? And I want to do a representation sort of similar to this one. Well, so in other words, I want to write phi, I'll write to write it like this, is equal to I lambda u omega, and then lambda z minus 1, f hat of lambda omega. Okay, but now I have to check what u I should put here, right? But, okay, so the idea, of course, is to solve the angular equation. So I'm going to solve g alpha beta, d alpha of u, d beta of u, is equal to zero. This, you know, this I can always do. On any Lorentzian metric, I can always find at least locally I can solve this. So I can plug it in there, and then I repeat the calculation, and the only thing I'm going to see is that now this is not going to be zero. So, it's unfortunate, but that's the way it is. So the only thing I'm going to get now is a parametric representation of solution of the wave equation in a curved space-time. And then this would be very important in any of the things I've talked about. Okay? So this is, you see why the Eilenberg equation is so important in relativity. Because if you want to have any representation of solutions of the wave equation, you need to solve the Eilenberg. Now I'll show you exactly the same calculation, but this time I'm going to rederive the fundamental solution of the wave equation in physical space based on this representation. So this was delta t squared minus x squared h plus t, which, as we said, it was one of absolute effects times delta t minus absolute. So again, everything is modulo constant. Alright, so I repeat the same calculation, but now I want to find that formula by looking at functions. So looking at functions delta of u. Right, so I take this is a pullback, I think this is a trivial pullback by u of the Dirac mass in R, right? So you go from R n plus 1, you go to R, here is delta 0, and you take the pullback, so you take u star of delta 0. That's what this is, right? That's tricky. I mean, it's very clear how to work with it. So, I want to see if I can find solutions of the wave equation, which look like this. Okay. Obviously, I know already that in Minkowski space I can find one, but you see if this gives me ideas of what to do in general. So I repeat exactly the same calculation. I take m alpha beta delta of a delta of u. So you get first of all two derivatives of a times delta of u. And this is just the wave operator applied to a, the first term that you see. The second term is 2m alpha beta d alpha of a, that's d beta of u, plus the version of u multiplied by first derivative of u. So these are all the terms that come from the first derivative of term number. Again, delta prime is just another distribution, which we all know. Okay. And then finally, I need to get the term which involves two derivatives of u, okay, which hopefully I will eliminate exactly by the Eichler equation I get. Because u, this u is also a solution of the Eichler equation. So t minus absolute value of x, u is t minus absolute value, is also a solution of the Eichler equation. In Minkowski's equation. Okay, so it's a different one because now you get null cones rather than null planes, but so what? Alright, so this is this term will be zero, therefore. If I pick up u to be a solution of the Eichler equation, this will be zero. And I'm just left with delta prime, so I have to do something about delta prime. Well, okay, so in this case, if I'm in Minkowski space, so this is a term that I want it to be zero. The first one is zero, the second one has to be zero also. And I check that if a is one over absolute value of x, I get indeed zero. Well, it's not very hard to see that this verifies this equation. Okay. And therefore, the only thing that I'm left with is the first term, n alpha beta d alpha d beta of a times delta of u. So you are left only with a term in delta of u, okay, which is the term which I'm calculating it here now. So it's derivation of a times delta of u. All the other terms are zero now. Again, they're zero because I'm mixing these very simple choices. By the way, when you solve this equation, you see it's another transport equation. It's also an ODE. It reduces to ODE because they're all first order equations. Right? So you get a equal 1 over absolute value of x. You plug it in here. Well, you get the derivation of a. A does not depend on t, therefore it's just minus Laplacian of x minus 1. Now this is a delta function in aspect. So you get the delta function times delta of u, but this is exactly the product of these two delta functions, just gives you the delta of at the origin, I mean at the point you open, which is what you wanted to do. So, okay, so that's all that is. Okay, so we have the idea, therefore, if I want to mimic this construction in a field space, that would be again to solve the Eichler equation. I will solve the Eichler equation. I have to do something else, which I didn't have to do before. I will also have to solve the transport equation. So these would be the two ingredients which I'm going to see if I want to solve. If I want to do something like the Kirchhoff formula in curved space time. Here are, again, these are the energy momentum tensor. General energy is depends on the wave equation, which we just discussed. Uniqueness and regularity. So this is something that I'm going to say. Okay, so now here's another very important aspect of wave equation, which we will need to understand, and that's decay. Solutions of the wave equation decay. Okay. So how do they decay? Well, it's not very hard to see from the Kirchhoff formula. If you use the Kirchhoff formula in dimension 3, of course in higher dimensions it's a bit more difficult. But even in higher dimensions, it's not so hard to see that you are going to get t to the minus n minus 1 over 2. So waves behave like t to the minus n minus 1 over 2. If you are more careful, you can even write down how this depends on the initial data. So you see, I need n plus 1 derivative of phi of the initial data in L1. Right? So this is a typical L infinity L1 estimate, or L1 infinity if you want, with a certain number of derivatives. You can guess the number of derivatives by dimensional analysis. Okay, so n plus 1 over 2 is natural. So this is, in fact, a scaling line in equality. By the way, for those of you who know, the L1 norm with derivatives doesn't work very well. Right? So you need careful, actually. So this, often you have to replace it by Hardy space. Okay, but anyway, this is just a technicality. Now, the reason why you have this decay, so Shakespeare said it very well. it's glory is like a certain water which never ceases to enlarge itself if by broad spreading it spreads to nothing. Right? So that's what happens if you try to become too powerful. Expand yourself until at every point you get less and less influence. Okay. So that's the reason. Of course you still need a proof, but a proof is not too complicated. In fact, we already had these representations. It's very easy to see that the way to do these sort of things nowadays is first to localize in Fourier space. So I'm looking at a cutoff in Fourier space, which is absolute power size between 1 half and 2. And then the solution, which we have discussed earlier, would look like this. So it's a cutoff. So in other words, the frequency is now localized. And again, you have, of course, the energy. This is the energy in equality, which is trivial in this case. So this is just much better. And but then you also can prove by stationary phase, so it's just a simple stationary phase analysis, which will give you this behavior in terms of just the one off. Now there is no derivative because you have localized everything to frequency one. Okay, but there is another method to get decay, and this method is much more. This is a very important method in general relativity. And in general, for equations which are quasi-linear or even semi-linear, there is a method of decay which does not use a fundamental solution at all. Instead, we try to use a vector field, which we have discussed. So we look. So here is the idea: you take p prime, just as a notation. It's a span. It's a set, if you want, of the vector fields t, which are the derivatives in the translations. The Lorentz transformations, which are x alpha d beta minus x beta d alpha, and S, which is a scalic. Okay? So you see, you have some operators which are weighted in, so they have different dimensions, right? Because L and S have x alpha times d alpha. So they are, this one has length minus 1, while this will have length 0, okay? If you look at the scalic. Alright, so what is the important point of the method is that these vector fields commute to the wave operator. So if I have the version of phi is equal to 0, then obviously I have also. So if I have the version of phi is equal to 0, then obviously x phi is also equal to 0. So this is a trivial calculation. The Lorentz group obviously commutes to the wave operator, but even the scaling commutes in part. Actually, the scaling would be could give you here some kind of two maybe times the dimension of phi. And if, therefore, if the dimension of phi is 0, this will also be if you have the scaling here. Otherwise, the Lorentz operator commute trivially with the wave operator. So, anyway, so if you have a solution of the wave equation and you hit it with one of these vector fields, you are going to get another solution. Therefore, I can apply the energy estimate for this. Right? So, I can take x1, xk, so I can take k vector fields, and look at the conservation of energy for them. So the energy of x1, xk, phi, the type t, is the energy, so this is the total energy that they are looking, right? So it's p of t, was discussed here. So I'm looking at the total energy at sigma, on sigma t, at fixed t. So conservation of energy tells me that this is equal to that, but zero, but this is just something on initial data. So, in particular, you see clearly that this quantity is essentially this quantity, right? So in other words, it's a weighted norm involving derivatives of f, k plus 1 derivative of the initial data, and k derivative of g, with a weight of 1 plus absolute value of k. Right? Okay, so that's good. Now, another remark that I want to make, which is very important, only what I'm going to say later, is that we should really see when you talk about the wave equation, solution of the wave equation, you have to understand that all the important things occur along null directions because these are the null geodesics, and the energy, all the energy of the wave equation should be transported along null geodesics. So, looking at frames using the ordinary frame, the ordinary frame is dt, d1, dn, the standard derivative semi-cos system. Using this frame, it's not well adapted to the wave equation. You are missing very important information which has to do with where the radiation is transmitted. And so it's a much better idea to use a null frame. So this is what null frames, why null frames are so important in relativity. You want to introduce dt plus dr, so dr being, dr here is xi, or absolute dr, so it's a radial, it's a derivative in the radial direction, the special radial direction. So you want to have dt plus dr and dt minus dr. And then the other vector fields you want to have, dA, are all perpendicular to both of them, and they span the sphere at every point. So at every point P, I have two null vector fields that go like this, and then these other ones span the orthogonal sphere on L and L. So these are the vector fields expressed here. And now, it's important to realize that the vector fields L and S, if you are going to get a decay estimate, it's going to come from the fact that L and S carry weights, right? So there are axes there. But the geometry of L and S is such that L and S are both parallel essentially to so at points along at points along the points along the null cone, L and S are actually tangent to the null cone, so they span the tangential directions of the null cone, so they are both parallel to this. In the interior, however, they span everything. So if you look. Ways of expressing the usual derivatives in terms of L and S, you see that you are going to get a linear combination of L and S with 1 over T minus absolute value of X coming up. So you gain a factor of 1 over T minus absolute value of X in the interior. So if absolute value of X is different from T, right, so absolute value of X is either much less than T over 2 or much larger than T over 2, then you are getting something which is interesting because you are getting a factor like 1 over T. But if you are exactly on the light cone, there is a degeneracy. The degeneracy is due to the fact that L and S becomes both tangent to the null cone. So you are missing, so along these directions, you are missing this direction. So at any point along the null cone, you are missing the transversal direction. Okay, so that's sort of the general philosophy why you will have the result which I'm going to mention now. So the result says the following. If I control these generalized energy norms involving vector fields, so the generalized energy norms are sort of generalized Sokolev norms. So if I control these generalized Sokolev norms with enough derivatives so that I can use something like I can get the subnorm from the L2 norms with derivatives from the Sokolev type norms, then I should get an inequality. Actually, the way it's written here is maybe a little bit misleading. So the correct way of writing it. Like this, then you get this d phi of t and f is less than this factor, so 1 over t plus absolute value of x is 1 over 2 times 1 over 1 plus t minus absolute value of x, which is a 1 half. And here there is this generalized energy norm. So this is a norm which involves all these derivatives, all these vector fields. So I'm taking sufficiently many vector fields. These are preserved, right? So this norm is bounded by the AIK that I have on the right-hand side. And therefore, as a consequence, so this is just bounded by initial data. So as a consequence, I get the solution of the wave equation, dk behaves like this, 1 over this times 1 over this. Right? So in particular, you get the rate t to the minus n minus 1 over 2 that we had earlier. But you get much more, because first of all, the norm which we had before, the dispersion inequality, in the dispersion inequality. So let me go back to explain what I mean by this word. So the dispersion inequality is exactly this one. whenever I talk about, I mention this notion, like, oh, I mean the 17 year one estimate, which is very standard in Fourier analysis. So that estimate, you see, it has a t to the minus n minus 1 over 2, but it doesn't give you anything in the interior. It doesn't tell you what happens inside the light or outside the light. It gives you only the sort of the optimal estimate, which is which is the one along null directions, but it doesn't tell you anything about the geometry of what's happening in the Gaussian sense, the wave in the Gaussian sense. So that's not a very good one. And the other problem is that it has an L1. L1 is not at all a good norm, because L2 is preserved, L1 is not. So it's not a good norm to use in any kind of nonlinear problem. While this one is expressed purely in terms of L2, so it just, this IK of FG is an L2 norm. So everything is expressed in terms of L2 norm, whose weights. But the weights are sort of, the correct weights are the ones that come from the vector fields. Okay? So the vector fields carry the correct weights, which you will not be able to do it any other way. Because if you try to, if you try to isolate the good directions from the bad directions, you have a lot of problems in derating energies. Okay, so this is the right way of doing it. And more, it's even more important, I get even more information from this point of view. Not only do I get the fact that derivatives of phi behave like this, and as you see, you get this factor of t minus 6 to the minus 1/2, right? Which in the interior tells you that you have better decay in the interior, which is what you expect from radiation, and the radiation should move only along the null directions. But it also tells you that every time I differentiate, if I differentiate the derivatives of phi, well, let me make an analogy. So in for harmonic functions, for solutions of Laplace equations in all of phi, every time you differentiate the solution, it decays better by a factor of 1 at infinity. Okay? This is not true about the wave equation. It's not true because if I take a solution of the wave equation, and I differentiate it, well, it's still going to decay like e to the minus n minus 1 over 2. There is no improvement. But there is no improvement because of exactly of the spinning estimate. So what the spinning estimate tells you that if you differentiate in the direction L and dr, which are, can you go back to that? So these are, so if you differentiate in these directions along the null, so the tangential directions, you get something better. The transversal direction is better. So you get no improvement in the transversal direction. And that's what it's very well given here in the spinning estimate. It tells you that the bad direction does not improve relative to this factor, but improves relative to this one. So it's better in the interior, but it's not better at all along the null direction. While these two derivatives, which are tangential, you see they improve in these factors. Right? So you get, they both behave now uniformly like e to the minus n plus 1 over 2 rather than t minus 2 minus 1. Okay, so you obviously gain. And this is very useful in the next step, which has to do with the null quadratic form. So this is another sort of important ingredient in everything I'm going to say later on. These are the non-quadratic forms, which the philosophy is very simple of this non-quadratic form. So I'll explain it, and then I'll finish. So now, you see, if I take two solutions of the wave equation and I multiply them, then I try to get an estimate, say in L2. Then, well, first of all, I have to have derivative, because the energy norms always comes up with negative. Anyway, this is not the PD, I can do the derivative. So it's some derivative times another derivative. And these are both solutions of the wave equation with reasonably initial data. Okay. So what is the best thing that you expect? Well, you can take, so this is, should write it like this, Lp infinity, Lx2. Right? So in other words, I take the L2 norm relative to the spatial values and take the supreme relative to the other. So what can you expect from here? Well, you can take d phi in an infinity times d psi in L2, and this is conserved. So this is this cannot decay. This is a less bounded, right? So this will be bounded in terms of the data. But this will decay like e to the minus n minus 1 over 2. Okay. That's it. I cannot do any better. Now, the malforms are designed so that you gain something. Instead of getting e to the minus n minus 1 over 2, I'm going to get e to the minus n over 2. And how do you get it? Well, it's very easy. The philosophy is very, very easy. You look at quadratic forms, which are such, like for example, 2 log of 5 psi, which is minus dt, so dt phi squared, dt phi dt psi, plus di by di psi. So I look at expressions like this, and I rewrite dt and di relative to the null frame, relative to LL bar and the EH. Okay. It's very easy to do. And the observation, so then why do I have to worry? I have to worry that when I do that, I'm going to get a term like L bar of phi times L bar of psi. This would be the worry, because this doesn't decay any better. But if the null form is such that this is excluded, in other words, when I rewrite these expressions with di, dj, I reinterpret that relative to the null form, null forms. Not null forms, null pairs, the Eilenberg bar. This is, by the way, what they call a null pair. And this is a canonical null pair in Minkowski's case. So if I express everything relative to the null pair, by the way, I'm sorry. Again, going too fast. So this is null pair, and of course it is a null frame also. So the null pair is just L and L bar, and the null frame is L and bar and dx. Okay, so if I express the di, the derivative, so d alpha phi dB dot psi, I express it relative to the null frame, I'm going to see that that term involving just L bar of phi and bar of psi will not be present. That's a miracle of the null quadratic forms. And as a consequence, I'm going to get a better estimate. So you can see, even point-wise, like a Q of 5 psi, I can express it in terms of something which is clearly better, because I get a factor of 1 over t, and then terms like this, and the gamma involves the vector fields. So that's a miracle of the null form. So the null form gives you something better. All right, so, I guess it's too late now. So next time I'll talk a little bit about applications of these ideas to non-linear equations. So you'll see that you can get quite a lot of mileage from this ingredient. So again, the ingredients were fundamental solution, understanding the fundamental solution in a geometric way by connecting it to the canonical equations, and then understanding this vector field method. By the way, the vector field method, as I expressed it here, doesn't quite give, so even though you can see that it's very powerful, doesn't give complete credit to what we call today the vector field method, because there are many, many other things that one can do with this. Not just the wave equation, you can do Maxwell equation. I think there's a big role in the action equations, and so on and so forth. And there are also, the vector field method has been expanded also by various people that I mentioned later on, to vector fields which are not necessarily connected to symmetries, but connected to something interesting in the equation, some still a geometric feature of a spacetime. So, for example, in Kerr or in Schwarzschild, you don't have enough symmetry. So, for example, Kerr has only two symmetries, the axial symmetry, which is not enough to do all this stuff. But so you have to get something else, and people, you know, have been able to squeeze many other informations from the geometry. So you construct vector fields which are naturally tied to the geometry of the black hole. Okay, and this is application.